Hey guys, I'm Tom the Tech Chap, and I've got a whole bunch of laptops right here because it is back to school season. I'm really sorry. I used to hate that. As soon as you broke up for the summer holidays, it was all back to school. Anyway, I've got my top six choices here for all budgets from about £350 all the way up to £1,600. So whatever you're studying, hopefully this will help you out. And I've also put links to every single one of these in the description below. All right, let's get into it. Okay, so let's kick off with what will probably be the best-selling back-to-school laptop this year, the new Apple MacBook Air. And with good reason, it really is a terrific laptop. And now that Apple have stopped selling the basic MacBook, the Air is the new entry-level point below the MacBook Pro. So it starts at £1,100, the same in dollars, but you can get up to £100 off with Apple's back-to-school promotion. It's also just been updated. The gorgeous high-res Retina display now has True Tone, which adjusts the colors to suit the lighting conditions around you and make it a bit more accurate and more comfortable to read. It's also got a newer version of Apple's keyboard, which they say has fixed a lot of the issues with the older models, along with that huge touchpad, two Thunderbolt 3 ports, and a Touch ID fingerprint reader. Now, the dual-core i5 processor isn't the most powerful, but it should have enough performance for most everyday tasks. And when it comes to battery life, Apple claim you'll get 12 to 13 hours, but realistically, you can expect around 10 hours of real-world use, so plenty to get you through a full day. The MacBook Air won't be for everyone. It needs more ports, it is quite expensive, and I know a lot of people do prefer using Windows, especially for compatibility with the programs they use at college. But if you have an iPhone and you're already in the Apple ecosystem, plus you can afford it, then yeah, I'd highly recommend it. Next up, we have the LG Gram 17. And I'll be honest with you, I've never seen a laptop quite like this before. It is definitely a premium option, but just look at that screen. 17-inch, almost bezel-less 2K, and it's also just insanely light. I mean, you have to try this for yourself.
That's thanks to the fancy nano-carbon magnesium alloy body, so it's actually lighter than most smaller 15-inch laptops, so you'll barely notice carrying this thing in your backpack. It's pretty powerful too, with the latest Intel i7 processor, 16GB of RAM, and 256GB of SSD storage. But for me, it's all about that screen, and having such a large, vibrant, and high-res display is what makes the Gram 17 so versatile. It's bright, which helps outdoors, has great color accuracy, and like a MacBook, it has a taller and narrower 16:10 aspect ratio, which I think makes it easier to work on. All this means it's great for graphical work, like photo editing, and it would be an ideal coding machine.
Battery life is also really good, like you'll easily get through a full day with this. There's a fingerprint reader built into the power button, which is handy, backlit keyboard, a good range of ports, including a USB-C Thunderbolt 3, which is actually one of the most versatile ports you can get. Ideally, every laptop should have one of these, but it means you can hook up external monitors, fast hard drives, even plug in external graphics cards docks. Graphics cards docks? Graphic card dock. Graphics card docks. Yes, graphics. And even plug in external graphics card docks so you can get some extra graphical horsepower.
If you do like the look of the Gram 17 but think it might just be a bit too big, then you might want to consider the smaller Gram 14, which actually weighs less than a kilogram.
It is expensive though, but overall, it's a stunning laptop. There's nothing else quite like this that has such a big, beautiful screen in such a lightweight chassis. I love this thing.
Where would any list of best laptops be without the Dell XPS 13? And for good reason. It's slim, light, powerful, and it's packed with features. It looks great, and the tiny bezels around the display means you get a 13-inch screen in a really compact body. The keyboard is great, the glass-covered trackpad is one of the best I've used, and the side-firing speakers are surprisingly loud and clear. Now, as for the screen, you can upgrade the Full HD display to a 4K touchscreen, but I wouldn't. The 4K is sharper and more color accurate, but it's expensive, it basically halves the battery life, and really it's kind of unnecessary on a 13-inch screen. For the XPS 15, I would go 4K. The Dell also gets two USB Type-C ports with Thunderbolt 3, along with a regular Type-C port, microSD card reader, and Bluetooth. The range starts at £1,000 or $900, but you'll want this one with an i5, 8GB of RAM, and 256GB of storage, which will set you back £1,200. For the price, it is a bit disappointing there's no dedicated graphics chip like an NVIDIA MX250, but for most of us, it's not really a big deal. And while it's certainly not cheap, it's a great all-rounder, I definitely recommend it.
Next up, we have the Huawei MateBook 13. And if I'm honest, I think this is actually better value than the Dell XPS 13. Similar specs, and it's still got a beautiful design, although you can't get over just how similar this looks to a certain fruit-based rival. But yeah, this is really a stunning laptop, and it costs about £750, so about £250 less than the Dell.
We also get a gorgeous 2K touchscreen, which is sharper than a normal Full HD laptop, a great keyboard, big touchpad, and solid specs. This one comes with an Intel i5, 8GB of RAM, and 256GB of storage. Little things too, like having Dolby Atmos tuned speakers, which are some of the best I've ever used on a laptop, a fingerprint reader in the power button, and fast charging through USB-C, which means you can use the same charger for your Android phone. Downsides? Well, it's got a pretty limited range of ports, just two USB-Cs, neither of which are Thunderbolt 3, along with a headphone jack, so you'll probably want to buy an adapter with it.
But there is a bit of an elephant in the room with this, and that's the Huawei controversy. Now, I don't want to get into politics, and at time of recording, basically, I think Trump has reversed the ban on Huawei, or intends to, so I personally would still confidently buy a Huawei laptop, or even a phone. If you are a bit worried about that, then I will go with the also excellent ASUS ZenBook UX433F as an alternative. Even cheaper still is the new Acer Swift 3. I love this thing, and it's such good value for money. If you're on a tight budget, I really, really recommend this.
The pick of the range has an i3 processor, 4GB of RAM, and 256GB of storage. The spec is a little bit different in the US, and actually even better value at $480. As usual, the UK pays a premium, but it's still very good for $580. But even with this more entry-level spec, it's still more than good enough to get through everyday tasks, and it helps keep costs down. It's got a great backlit keyboard, fingerprint reader, and even an aluminium body, which feels great.
Battery life is also pretty good because we've got less powerful components. It can last a little bit longer, I'd reckon around 7 or 8 hours, so easy to get you through a full school day. And there's also a really solid range of ports. You've got everything you need. Full-size SD card reader, a couple of USB 3s, one USB 2 for some reason, and also a USB-C, which is helpful, but it's not Thunderbolt 3, but it's to be expected given the price range not to have it.
So it's not the best looking or the slimmest around, a bit like me really, but solid performance, a good screen, and long battery life makes this a bit of a steal at this price.
And finally, no back to school buying guide would be complete without one of these, a Chromebook. And right now, I think the Acer Chromebook 14 is the best option.
It's just £350, the same in dollars, although I have seen it as cheap as £250, and you get a 14-inch laptop that runs Chrome OS instead of Windows. Chromebooks are incredibly popular with students, and as I say, it runs Google's own software, Chrome OS, and since it has a relatively small 32GB of storage, really is designed for using programs in the cloud. So for example, writing up notes in class in a Google Doc, storing your files in Dropbox, streaming Netflix. Most of what we do is online anyway, so while you can't install games or traditional programs you might on a Windows or Mac laptop, for a lot of us, this is all we really need. Plus, it has a solid 10-hour battery life, it looks pretty good, and you just can't beat the price.
But you can probably see my biggest issue with it, and it's that screen. It's a TN, and it's fine. No, it's not fine. It's not good, really. Maybe this would be best if you could have a second monitor to output to, but you can see it has terrible viewing angles, and even up front the colors are a little bit washed out. It's okay for when you're on the go and just taking notes or something, but maybe when you get back to your student halls or the office, you might want to plug it into an external monitor or something. So they're my top six choices right now for a back to school laptop, but there are loads of other options. If you prefer more of a tablet experience, you could go with a Microsoft Surface Go and get a keyboard, or an iPad Air, which also has a smart connector, and get one of the smart keyboards with that. Or if you need something a bit more powerful with a proper dedicated graphics card, you could get the Dell XPS 15 or the MacBook Pro 15, or maybe, this one, the Acer Concept D7, which I'm using as my main workhorse at the moment. Obviously, they are a lot more expensive and less portable, but more powerful options. So I hope that was useful. Go and check out the links in the description if you want to find out more, and also let me know in the comments what laptop you're using, and if you are going back to school in September, where you're going, what you're doing, just give me your life story. Just tell me everything. Thank you so much for watching, guys. Hit that like and subscribe button, and I'll see you next time right here on the Tech Chat.